right. That's why you push so hard. That's why we walk this thing out every single day. It's because we know that we have a reward in heaven. Remember, we aren't doing it for a reward. We're doing it because for us to live is Christ. Christ is us. We are Christ. We belong to Him. That's why we live the way we live. Believer, be encouraged to continue on in this fight. Continue on down this road. The road is hard. Christ said in His own words, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Why do you say that? Because it's true. When it's hard, praise God. Why? Because His strength is made perfect when it's hard. His strength is made perfect in our weaknesses. When you feel like you can't go on anymore, when you feel like you're just stuck in a rut, be encouraged, saint. That's what the Father calls us as. That's what the Father sees us as. He sees us as saints, His saints, that He's chosen, that He's adopted, that He's engrafted into His family. But we gotta try that thing out. Because saint means holy one. Let's live holy. Let's continue with the text. It says this. Verse 27. From the time of when was born, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife. Then she bore him a son. But the thing that David had done was evil in the sight of the Lord. Remember, the text could have said this earlier. What specifically is the text looking at saying this was evil in the sight of the Lord? One, it's killing Uriah. Two, it's pretending to be this goal out knowing that you have already impregnated her. That false righteousness, that pseudo righteousness, that vagueness, this is displeasing in the sight of the Lord. That's why he calls for us to take off the mask. Just take it off. It's easier. It's better that way. Just be honest with who you are, who Christ has created you to be, and press toward the mark. Remember, Philippians 1:6, that he who has begun a good work within you will complete it. So if Christ has truly started the work within you, continue to trust Him. Why? Because He started the work. It wasn't your efforts. It wasn't your doing that got the work in motion. And it's not going to be your doing that's going to keep it in motion. You submit yourself unto the Holy Spirit as you work. But if you continue in the text, we're just going to finish that. Verse 13, I just want to kind of want us to grab that. This is the part where it's really going to be applying to us as we look. But as we look to chapter number 12, so that's just the very next chapter after verse number 27. The point here is just that God exposes David's utter foolishness to him. God exposes David's utter foolishness to him because up to this point, David still don't get it. He thinks, oh, I'm good in people's eyes. The people are going to be proud of me. I'm this go-well. I'm really doing something real hardy. I've taken her in as my wife. But mind you, by this time already, David has already multiplied lives, which is also displeasing inside the Lord. So don't think, oh, Bathsheba's the one that messed him up, because that's what a lot of preachers do when they get grabbed this text. They say, oh, Bathsheba was that one that messed him up. No, David was already messed up. This showed forth more fruit of how messed up he was. Why? Because he started doing what the world was doing. The Bible tells us Romans 12, 1 and 2, be not conformed to the ways of this world, but be ye transformed by the renewal of your mind. That's what our job is. But David was having his mind just like the people in the nations and the pagan nations that he was around with this multiplying of wives. That was never what God had commanded. That was never what God had in plan. Because there are a lot of people who also preach the message that, hey, this is God's blessing upon this marriage because David ended up turning it around and doing it the right way. So therefore, if two people have a kid and it's kind of like this situation is, then if they get married, then that makes it all better. Even if it's polygamy, it makes it all better. It doesn't. It doesn't. Because remember, you're trying to just toss the bubblegum, but now you're actually stepping in it because you forgot where you put it. But if the team of the text, verse number 1, chapter number 12, this is going to be God's exposing of David's utter foolishness. He has to expose it to David because David still does not get it. Verse 1 says, then the Lord sent Nathan to David. And he came to him and said, there were two men in one city, and one rich and the other poor. The rich man had a great many flocks and herds, But the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb, which he brought, and he bought, and he nourished. And it grew up together with him and his children. It would eat of his bread and drink of his cup and lie in his bosom, and was like a daughter to him. Now, a traveler came to the rich man, and he was unwilling to take from his own flock or his own herd to prepare for the wayfarer who had come to him. Rather, he took the poor man's ewe lamb and prepared it for the man who had come to him. If you pause right here, just understand the story. There's this rich man, there's this poor man. One who has a whole bunch of stuff, one who has one little ewe lamb. There's this traveler that comes, and he comes to the rich man. The rich man says, hey, I think it's better for you to just take this man's one and then go on about your way instead of taking any from my many. Now, let's look at David's response. Verse 5. Then David's anger burned greatly against the man, and he said to Nathan, as the Lord lives, surely the man who has done this deserves to die. If we pause real quick, remember, David being a man of God's heart, he understood God's word. He loved God's word. But there are times and ways in which in the believer's life, we can understand God's word outwardly by looking at other people. But when it comes to our own hearts, we still don't get it. If we rest right here for a moment, believe all of the study, all of the preparation in the text, all of the times where we come here for Bible study, we come here for all these good things, that is excellent. That is exactly what we're supposed to be doing. You don't understand how your heart is to be transformed in getting all of this information about the Lord Jesus Christ. We get it just like David. Where if somebody tells us something, oh, I know the exact way to handle that. I know the exact way to do this thing. I know the exact way. What Nathan's going to reveal to him is, oh, no, this is you. But David, how does David not get this? David understands the law of God. He loves the law of God. But here, he misses that he's talking about himself. Let's continue with the text. It says this, verse 6. He must make restitution for the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and had no compassion. So David's understanding is, hey, we would have compassion. Why? Because God has always told us all throughout the years that we'd have compassion on the sojourner, on the traveler, on the stranger. Would it be having compassion on him? This rich person showed no compassion at all by taking this one person, this little ewe lamb, when they had men, they had lambs, and they had flocks, and they had herds. And he took the one. So he understood. He said, he must make restitution for the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and had no compassion. So he's talking about dying, but then he's talking about making restitution fourfold. So basically what David is saying here, death should strike this man four times. This is what David is saying. Death should strike this man four times. But now let's look at the text and let's see what happens. Verse 7, Nathan says this to David. You are the man! Exclamation mark. Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, it is I who anointed you king over Israel, and it is I who delivered you from the hand of Saul. I also gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your care, and I gave you the house of Israel and Judah, and if that had been too little, I would have added to you many more things like these. David, why are you acting like this? You have everything. You have the power, you have the prestige, you have the possessions, you have the privilege, you have everything under you. But you're the one who took this one little ewe lamb from this person who had only one, and you have all the many. You have all the many. And what we're going to see in this judgment that God gets today, you said it exactly right when you said fourfold judgment. You said it exactly right. Here we go. In the text it says this, verse 9. Why have you despised the word of the Lord by doing evil in his sight? You have struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword, have taken his wife to be your wife, and have killed him with the sword of the sons of Ammon. Now therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house because you have despised me, have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Continue the text. Verse 11. Thus saith the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against you from your own household. I will even take your wives from before your eyes and give them to your companion, and he will lie with their wives in broad daylight. Now mind you, this is God speaking now. So this is literally, so at first it was prophecy. now it's literally God speaking, saying, I have done these things for you. And so now as we see this, like literally what God is saying is, I'm going to make sure that these things happen to you, David, because of what it is that you have done. But if we go back to the beginning, it started off as just this thing of come. Hey, I'll just do this real quick. And then once I finish, I'll just dispose of her because she's no use to me anymore. But he tossed his gum, and now he's stepping in his gum. If we look at this, what we end up seeing is we end up seeing that God is chosen specifically to judge David. He's saying that he's making promises that he will make sure that these things actually come to happen and actually take place. But if we finish and we read down to verse 13, I'll give us some principles for us to understand what's going on here as we are able to apply it to our lives. Because remember, none of this means anything if we don't know how to apply this even to our own lives and what the warning is for us. Because remember, these scriptures, the Old Testament scriptures, are given to us as a warning, even in the good ways as an example. What we have here is verse number 12. It says, indeed, you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel and under the sun. Then David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said to David, the Lord also has taken away your sin. You shall not die. If we pause right here, this is a lot of times where we ourselves live as believers. We live so much so under the graciousness of God to where when God doesn't punish us, when we don't step in our gum, when nobody else steps in our gum, when our gum is secure underneath the desk, we're like, oh man. And then guess what we end up doing? The same thing again. A lot of times it's good for us that somebody finds out the gum, they grab the gum, they have some sort of interaction with the gum. Why? Because now that causes for us to actually live in a proper way towards God, because our tossing of our gum was found out. Our sin was found out. The things that we did were actually found out. And so that actually works to our benefit. Because a lot of times, all the time, God is so gracious